Hi, friends, and welcome to Marvelous Friends, your home for all things Marvel Cinematic Universe and beyond. I'm Rhett, and... Well, I guess you know what we're talking about today. Roll back credit. Back in November, John Cena posted a rather cryptic Instagram post that included just Captain America's shield with the Black Panther claw mark across it. There was no tags, no caption to it, just the picture. And no one knew what this was about. Flash forward to this week, and we do. Turns out, we have a new Captain America, and it's, well... Yeah. Now don't worry, John Cena is not replacing Steve Rogers' Captain America. What is important to remember is that there are many adaptations of this super soldier, and quite a few different characters have held the mantle of Captain America over the years. In fact, in this upcoming Disney Plus series, Falcon and the Winter Soldier, we have three characters already who have held the mantle in one way or another. Well, make that four now. If the rumors are true, John Cena will be joining the cast of this series as Captain America. Well, Captain America, U.S. Agent, a.k.a. John Walker. Now, this is a completely different adaptation of Captain America, and is completely separate to that version that is Steve Rogers. In fact, it's completely different than even the version that has been passed on to Sam Wilson. So in this video, I'm going to break down what this could potentially mean for the plot of the show, and exactly who is John Walker, Captain America, U.S. Agent. Now, let's start off by talking about the show itself. Now, potentially, if this is correct, the show has probably been in production for a while now. Pretty sneaky, Marvel. If that Instagram post back in November was correct, that means that for a year now, John Cena has been locked into this position. And back in May, we've got confirmation that both Agent 13 and Zemo would be returning for this show as well. Which means we could pretty much be pretty far into actual filming already without really anyone knowing it. Which means, to me, I most likely see this being one of the first shows to premiere on the platform, potentially coming around the holidays. I don't suspect that we'll really have any of these main titles right away at the beginning of the launch in November, allowing the launch itself to have a moment, and then premiering all the individual kind of showrunner titles for the platform thereafter, allowing each of them to kind of have their own special premiere moment. I also want to go ahead and say that this will probably be a 6-hour runtime as well. Not sure how they'll break it up. Most likely, though, in 60-minute segments would be my best guess. Now, this is just because we know that other programs will receive the same runtime. In my opinion, this show will probably open up shortly after the events of Endgame, with Falcon kind of contemplating what it means now that he has been given the title of Captain America. Though there's little time to rest as him and Bucky are sent out on a mission, something to do with some kind of experiment to create the Super Soldier Serum. What I kind of feel is that we will be seeing one particular effect from the events of Endgame in the series. Now, in Endgame, of course, Captain America chose to stay behind and live his life with Peggy Carter, returning as a much, much older man at Tony Stark's funeral. Now, this is when, of course, he passed on the mantle to Sam Wilson. However, during this time that he has now been alive since World War II, in that current timeline, there's been a lot more chances for them to get samples and try to recreate this Super Soldier Serum. Now, this was something that had been prevented up to this point because they only had a limited number of samples available after the events of Project Reborn, with Captain America displaced in time. So now with him being there longer, there could have been more chances for there to be experiments and reproductions of that Super Soldier Serum within Captain America, whether he's okay with it or not. So this, I think, will again be one of those major themes and probably the major conflicts that we'll see for Bucky and Sam Wilson. What Sam and Bucky will come across, though, is that these super soldier experiments with this kind of potential version of the super serum is being done on orphans. Now, this is dark, but stay with me because this actually comes from the comics. In one storyline of the comics, Baron Zemo actually is married to a Baroness Zemo. During this storyline, they actually adopt a group of children who are orphans, brainwashing them and adopting them as their own kind of army of foot soldiers called the Kinder. These Kinder groups then doing basically their bidding, both for the Baron and Baroness, as well as the Nazi Party as a whole. Now, eventually, the Kinders are set free and released of their brainwashing by Captain America, along with a partner called Diamondback. Now, I don't suspect that we will see Diamondback, though it would be a fun reference, as she actually is the sister of Crossbones, who we have seen in the MCU already. Either way, though, I think this will be kind of one of those moments where they happen upon this, find this, and ultimately find out that it is Zemo who is behind it. However, he has already escaped from the scene, and they're just a little bit too late to catch him. We'll now kind of jump back and pick up a story on Zemo and kind of what's been going on since Civil War. Specifically, I think we'll see him start off with his escape from Wakanda, taking advantage of the chaos from the snap, and of course the invasion of Thanos during the kind of initial battle there at Wakanda's border. Now, I assume, and that's my own assumption, that he is being held at Wakanda, but it makes the most sense to me, as the last person we see him interacting with in the events of Civil War is, of course, Black Panther, and it would make sense for Black Panther to take him in for trial and punishment at Wakanda, since his major crime was the terrorist attack that killed the previous Wakandan king. Now, him making his escape during this time, he does, of course, then grow back to power, and we kind of get the focal point of what he's been going on to build his revenge, not only wanting to take on the Avengers now, but the entire world as a whole, as he sees that they are wrong for siding with the Avengers and still thinks they need to be punished. And I also want to say that I do find that he will be the major baddie and a much bigger player in this franchise. Now, in the Civil War, the major conflict was actually between the growing kind of headbutting between Captain America and Iron Man, and Zemo was really just there to be the pot stirrer and cause kind of all the clues about what actually happened in the past to come out. And so to bring him back and then to use him kind of as just a secondary background character would be kind of a disservice to such a major Captain America character from the comics. So I think he would be playing a major role in whatever the conflict is and being our kind of overarching primary villain. After this flashback with Zemo, we will then kind of jump back to the events at the orphanage, where now, after everything's kind of wrapped up, we get the first introduction to John Cena's U.S. agent. Now, him, of course, responding to the same kind of cry for help or information that was out there regarding the events at this orphanage, just being a little bit later than our Avengers. Now, of course, him decked out in his full U.S. agent uniform that looks awfully a lot like Captain America, this will definitely raise some questions for both Sam and Bucky, kind of asking who he is and challenging his authority to wear that outfit, knowing who the real Captain America is. Now, I kind of picture here the U.S. agent giving somewhat of a comedic kind of mission statement and monologue about who he is and what he's here to do. Think something along the lines of like Sailor Moon in the anime, whenever she's about to give out that final blow to a bad guy, she has her little saying that she always says. I think that would be kind of a funny element if he had a mantra somewhat like that. Now, I think these two will then butt heads, because if you do remember, both Sam and Bucky are still fugitives of the U.S. government, having escaped imprisonment after the events of Civil War, and then just kind of skated by because of the events of Infinity War, and then them being dusted for the last 5 years. So him trying to take the two in, and those two fighting back because they don't take this phony of a Captain America seriously and see him as a threat because they know who the true Captain America actually is. Now, I will point out that I don't see that at this point Captain America style suit on Falcon yet, him still not fully taking on the mantle. We'll see that probably later in the series. Now enter Agent 13. I see her once again filling that kind of inside man role that she had during the events of Civil War. Now I'm not 100% sure where she will fall within the government structure. It's important to know that the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. show has really shown kind of an on-again, off-again, will-they-won't-they relationship between S.H.I.E.L.D. and the U.S. government. And also, it's important to know that Nick Fury and Maria Hill, though they are very kind of still connected super spy representatives, they are actually not the leaders of S.H.I.E.L.D. right now. Now, this is going to be a couple big spoilers if you enjoyed the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. show but have not caught up to the most recent season. Currently, Mac is the director of S.H.I.E.L.D. after Agent Coulson, well, I should say Director Coulson, actually dies for real in the series. So neither Maria or Fury are in kind of leadership positions with that, acting independently, much like the Avengers do act independently of S.H.I.E.L.D. as well. All three of them kind of a trinity of power that works along the side of each other, along with the U.S. government as well, Often, though, what caused this divergence between the government and these agencies is the fact that the U.S. government, of course, is looking out for their best interests first and not necessarily the world's, like the other three groups are. So it's really hard to say where she will fall. I could see her still as a SHIELD agent. I could see her also being more of a direct inside man with the U.S. military, which might make a little bit more sense because I could see this U.S. agent, Captain America, definitely being part of the government and not so much an agent of SHIELD. Now, of course, Agent 13 will have information on this and help our duo kind of sort out what is fact and everything that regarding the character, as well as kind of offer them support as they track down Zemo. Now, the series will continue with them going on various missions, trying to stop Zemo and his super soldier kind of experiments that he's on as they also try to bring him in again. Each of these times, though, they seem to kind of run into U.S. Agent Captain America, not really knowing what's going on. They sometimes fight against each other. They sometimes work with each other. It's a very kind of, well, they want their relationship here as well, as they're not sure where the other one's allegiances really fall. However, eventually it will come out, though, that the U.S. agent, Captain America, is not who he says he was. Let's stop off at a small tie-in to WandaVision here. Now, as I mentioned in my WandaVision plot prediction story, which you can see up in the card, there is going to be a major adversary for them called the Grim Reaper. And in this, I mentioned that he has a brother. And no, the brother is not John Walker, but his brother is a hero, and that hero, of course, is Wonder Man. But as you find out in the comics, Wonder Man is being controlled and was created by Zemo, who is using him as a pawn to infiltrate the Avengers and destroy them, ultimately, of course, realizing what's going on and sacrificing himself against Zemo to save the Avengers. Here, we could see a very similar thing with U.S. Agent, which also would fit in the fact that in the comics, U.S. Agent is created very similarly. Created by the Commission of Superhero Alliance under the influence of the Red Skull, the U.S. agent is in everything he is cracked up to be. Now, in this iteration, the CSA would be replaced by the Sokovia Accords, and of course, Red Skull would be replaced by Zemo, kind of tying both the story of Wonder Man and U.S. agent together and kind of mixing them up. In the comics as well, U.S. agent has three kind of sidekicks, one of them being his Bucky, and it's called Battlestar, and then also having Left Ringer and White Ringer as well. These kind of could represent Falcon as well as either Agent 13 or Black Widow, who have both kind of assisted Captain America on the various missions. Now, I say that we will probably see them as very minor roles, maybe being named Strike Force members that kind of support the U.S. agent. This will now put Falcon, who is trying to prove himself as Captain America's chosen replacement, against the U.S. government's created replacement as well. Them kind of fighting head-to-head against one another as both him and Bucky try to expose U.S. agent for who he is and what his connections are to Zemo, while at the same time they have to fend off everything Zemo is sending at them to try to prevent them from revealing this information. Eventually being able to break this brainwashing of Zemo with the good old cognitive recalibration, or as Black Widow says, hitting them really hard on the head. This would then of course allow them to work together to take down Zemo, much like Wonder Man eventually worked with the Avengers to do so in the comics. Again, that parallel kind of switching out characters for one another from the comic book references. This ultimately being successful allows them to kind of continue on with U.S. agent. Now, there's a bunch of different ways he could potentially be used, popping up in films, or potentially considering John Cena is a pretty good get, they might continue on with his own franchise altogether, giving him a Disney Plus show of his own. This would then allow Bucky and the Falcon to return to the big screen, which I think would be very appropriate because I think that would open the doors for Captain America 4, Sam Wilson, which with him fully adapting into that role as the new Captain America and continuing on that franchise from there with the new Cap. That being said, though, I will be very disappointed if we do not get to see a full Star-Spangled Banner version of the Falcon suit in that final showdown between Zemo, potentially U.S. agent, and Falcon and Winter Soldier. What do you think of this? Do you like the idea of introducing a rival Captain America? And do you like John Cena for that role? Personally, for me, this makes me a lot more excited for this franchise if it's true. I honestly wasn't too excited for it. Of course, I was going to watch it, but considering the Falcon and Bucky aren't really my favorite MCU characters out of all the options to get their own series, I wasn't totally thrilled for this series. So this has kind of revamped my interest. I would like to know what your thoughts, though, of course, down in those comments. As we get more information about this and other MCU projects, I will be, of course, passing that along here on the channel, so subscribe and set those alerts, because you don't want to miss a thing. Until then, though, I love you all 3,000. I hope you have a marvelous rest of your day, Bye, friend.